All right, so today we're going to be talking about the learning curve and some of the terminology behind it. Performance of tasks typically show improvement when a task is done over and over again, and the time required to perform that task generally decreases with, you know, a person, a worker, you know, constantly doing the same task, or a person just doing the same task over and over again. An example of this for this class would be how everyone has been improving on their presentations every week. You know, at the beginning of the semester, you know, some of the presentations weren't as long as they were supposed to be, or, you know, didn't cover some of the things that should have been covered. But, you know, as the weeks went on and you kind of got an idea of what's expected and got comfortable with, you know, talking, you know, in our case, not in front of each other, but talking for, you know, 5 to 10 minutes about a topic, you know, you got a lot better and, you know, seem to be more comfortable at doing it. Another example of that would be just like riding a bike when you, I don't know if you remember when you first learned how to ride a bike, but when you first learned how to ride a bike, you may have not been able to, you know, stay upright as long. You know, you'll start riding after somebody's pushing you, you know, you might drift and fall, but then you gradually, as you kept, you know, getting back up and kept trying to ride the bike, you know, you got better and got faster at riding a bike. So learning curve is the degree of an improvement and the number of tasks needed to realize the improvement as a function of the task being completed. So if a task is short and routine, there will only be a modest improvement that'll be noticed. If a task is a little bit longer and more complex, the improvements will occur over a longer time. So because of this learning, because of these learning factors, they have little relevance for planning or scheduling of a routine activity. But it does have relevance for newer complex repetitive activities. This learning effect that I just referred to, it refers to the belief that time per repetition decreases as the number of repetition increases. So the more times that you do something, the more effective and the better you get at doing it. So it's agreed that the learning effect is the result of workers learning and other factors. Some of the factors include, you know, pre-production factors. So you select some tools, you select equipment. You work on those tools and work with those tools and work on that equipment. After using it, you know, for so long, you should become more proficient at, you know, working with the tools or using the equipment. Changes made after production has begun. So you'll learn something, you know, if something changes in the process of you, you know, producing something, you know, if it changes, you know, you might have to learn something new, but once you learn it and start doing that new, you know, that new thing, you become a little more proficient at it. And then managerial factors, management can assist with learning, giving you new tasks and giving you things to learn and, you know, having you do it over and over again, you know, you become better. And they also will schedule certain tasks at certain times so that you can learn at certain times or perform the task at certain times. Changes that are made once production is underway can cause a temporary increase in time per unit, per worker, as the worker adjusts to the improvement. So You see the two curves, this bottom right-hand corner curve. This one kind of tells you, this kind of displays where, you know, the time decreases per unit. It goes down, but once an improvement happens, you see the dash line that goes up. You have to learn that new task, or you have to learn that new improvement. But once you learn it, the time starts decreasing again, and you add more, you know, you can produce more. But then if another improvement happens right here, it goes up again, not as much, not as high, but it'll go up, and then it'll start decreasing. And same thing. So as improvements happen in a process, that may cause, you know, the production of some units to decrease for a short period of time. But once you become proficient at it, you know, you'll start to improve, or the time will start improving and your output will start improving. This chart up here is pretty much the first thing where you're learning something. Once you pick up on it, you start to decrease, you know, the time that it takes you to produce a unit, it starts to decrease, but then it'll start leveling out at some point. So that's what those two graphs show. So a few things about the learning effect. It's very predictable. So once you'll see in some of the examples that we do in a few minutes, once we find out what a learning rate is, what the learning rate is, we're going to continue to use that learning rate. So it's constant. Every doubling of repetition. So again, you'll see this in the examples that we're going to do very shortly, but we'll start off with, you know, a certain unit number, and then as we add on units, the units are going to double over time. So you'll see this. So it'll double in repetition. All right, so now we're going to work on come up with the unit time using the doubling, which I just mentioned about the learning effect. So the first unit, as you can see, the first unit of a process took 10 minutes or 10 hours, and the learning rate is 80%. So all throughout this equation or this example, we're going to use the learning rate of 80%. And again, you keep in mind that the output or the units produced, those will double. So you see a 1, you know, it doubles to 2. It doubles to 4, and on the right hand side, the unit time, again, the first unit took 10 hours. The second unit, we're gonna multiply that by the learning rate. We're gonna multiply the previous unit time by the learning rate to come up with an estimated, you know, number of hours it's gonna take to produce, you know, the second unit. And then we go down to the fourth unit, and we're going to use the previous time times the learning rate to come up with that time. All right, so as you can see, as we double up on the units, we see that the number of hours that it takes to produce that unit, it decreases. And that's what the learning curve showed, and what learning effect, you know, proves or shows. It shows that as you continue to produce something or continue to do something, that time it takes for you to do it, it decreases over time. So you can see that in this example. All right, so, you know, using the learning effect, where we're doubling up on the units and using the learning rate, multiplying that by the previous unit time, we can come up with, you know, the units that aren't listed here. And there's two different ways that we can come up with that. You know, like instead of, you know, going 1, 2, 4, well, what about unit 3? Or what about unit 5, 6, 7? Or unit 11, 12, 13, 14, 15? You know, what times could we expect from, you know, producing that unit? Well, there's two different ways. You can, the first way is to use this formula right here, which is on slide 7S-9. Let me go to that slide. So 7-9. So using this formula, which I typed in the Excel, you can kind of guess or estimate how long it takes to do whatever unit. All right, so we'll move that down there so you can see it, just in case this confuses you. So TN is the time that we need to solve for, or the unit number that we need to find the time for. T1 is the time of the first unit, and then B is the log of the learning rate divided by log of two. And we'll always use log of two for this example. So if we wanted to find the time for unit number three, or the third unit that was produced, using the learning curve rate of 80%, where it took 10 minutes to complete the first unit, we would first want to come up with, you know, the numbers to put in for the exponent, which would be, you know, the n to the b power. So I already went up and looked or calculated the log of 2. That gives you 0.301. Since we're doing this remotely, I'm going to use online. So if you wanted to calculate the log of 0.80, either you can use your calculator and type log 0.80, or go online, find a calculator and put 0.8 equals, and we come up with negative 0.0969. So we would put negative 0.0969. All right, so after we do that, we come up with our equation. So T3, which, because we want to know the unit 3, we want to know how long it takes to produce unit 3. That equals 10, which is the first unit that was produced. That's how long it took. And in parentheses, you have 3, which is the one you're trying to calculate, to the, so we would use negative 0.9 or 0.0969, and then divide that by 0.3010. And if we put that in the calculator, so negative 0.0969 divided by 0.3010. So that gives us T3 equals 10 times 3 to the negative 0.3219 power. Equals 10, and then in parentheses, again, since we're doing this, we can go and find a calculator. You put x is 3, that's the unit number that we're trying to figure out, and then the exponent that we need to use is negative 0.3219. We calculate it, that gives us 0.0721. So this would be 0.7201. I think that's what it was. Yep. And then we would multiply 10 times 0.721, So 10 times 0.7201, and that would equal 7.21 hours, or 7.2 hours. So for unit 3, we can estimate that it took 7.2 hours. So it seems like a lot of work, I know, but you don't have to worry about it for your quiz, because we're going to use the second approach. We're going to use the actual table that's in the book. So if you go into your book, and it's on page 338. So if you know the learning rate, which is 80%, and we go down to unit number 3, 0.702. So we would multiply that by 10, which, let me go here. So we will multiply that by 10, and that would give us our 7.2 hours. So that's the easier way to do it. That's the way you're going to be expected to do it on your quiz and any homework assignment I give you. So I did a wrong calculation, so make sure you change that calculation. So it's 7.02. So if we wanted to calculate the unit time for unit number 10 using the table instead of the equation, you would use the equation is listed on page 339 in your book, but you would use how long it took for the first hour, which was 4, and you would multiply that by the time you would use 80%, the 80% area, and you would go down to unit 10 and multiply by 0.477. So 0.477. And that would equal 1.98. Did I get it right? Yeah, 0.477. So 1.98 hours. So if we wanted to do it for unit 6, 3, 15, 12, we would use that equation. All right, so as we, try to figure out the different units that were produced, the times to the different units produced, we can come up with it by, using the time from the first unit produced and multiply it by the number that corresponds with whatever the learning rate and the unit number on the left-hand side. So that's the easiest way to do it. You could, if you want to, you can use the formula. It's a little bit more work involved, but for the assignments that you get, that you receive, you'll be able to use the table that's in the book. So the learning curve theory can be used, and it's very useful and can be applied to the business world. A few things that it can be applied to. First thing, manpower planning and rescheduling. So the knowledge received from the output projections that you get from, like, the learning curve, the learning effect equations, and the learning curve theory can help managers make better decisions about how many workers they need based off of the initial output rates. So once you figure out what the initial output is, like how long it takes to produce one thing, you can start kind of like forecasting or guesstimating, how long it's going to take for that person to produce, so many other, units. So managers do expect that improvement will occur because, with the number of repetitions, as I stated before, once you start doing something over and over again, you start getting better at it, or you should be getting better at it. And the time that it takes you to do that should decrease. The next thing is negotiating purchases. Often, you know, negotiating when you do purchases, it involves contracting for, you know, specialized items that may have a high degree of complexity. Some examples of this would be like airplanes and computers that are produced. Those are a little more, have a higher complexity to them. Direct labor costs of those, you know, producing those things should decrease as the order size increases, because again, people are producing, you know, something, the same thing. So their learning curve is going to generally, it's going to go down. So as you do more and more, you know, produce more and more, you know, the time it takes for you to produce that will decrease because you have a little bit more knowledge of that. So when negotiators do, or when companies do negotiate for prices, the first thing they settle on is usually how many units are going to be produced or how many units they're going to purchase. Then they'll negotiate the price, because they kind of figure that, you know, as we purchase more and more goods, well, you know, 9 times out of 10, it's taking you less and less time to produce those goods because of the learning curve. Budgeting, purchasing, and inventory planning. The learning curve projections help managers plan costs, you know, labor, and inventory needs. Again, the initial cost per unit may be high, and the output of the, you know, the units that are produced, it might be low, but over time, you know, that production is going to go higher, and the cost of the unit to produce that unit should go down because of less and less time that's used to produce it. So a few things to consider about the learning curve. The learning rates may differ from organization to organization based off of the employees that are working on the units, or the conditions that the employees are working in, and the abilities of the employees. Projections based on learning curve should be regarded as estimations. So these should be used kind of like forecasts when you try to estimate things based off a learning curve. So it's not the actual number. So just keep that in mind. These are projections, not actual numbers. So, you know, if it doesn't take you that amount of time that you estimate, then don't get too concerned or anything like that. Just know that, you know, as people learn, they learn, you know, certain things, you know, as they do it more and more, again, they'll get quicker and better at doing it, or they should. All right, so the last thing we're going to do is figure out how to estimate learning rates. And I have a PowerPoint, or not PowerPoint, but Excel example for that. All right, so for this example, a manager wants to determine an appropriate learning rate for a new type of work his firm will undertake. They have obtained completion times for the initial 6 repetitions of a job of this type. What learning rate is appropriate? Now, you're going to need to learn, you're going to need to know how to do this for your current event assignment. So I recommend you pay attention to this. So according to the learning curve theory, the time per unit decreases at a constant rate each time the unit doubles, output doubles. So 1 to 2, 2 to 4, 3 to 6. So based off of that, what we would do, we would take the completion rates from unit 2 and divide it by unit 1. So if we were to do that, we would say 12, that equals 12 divided by 15.9. And then that would equal 12 divided by 15.9, that equals 0.7547. or 0.755. And we can do the same thing for units 2 to 4. So as you can see, as we go through, I would say that the learning rate would be 0.75 or 75%. So the learning rate that's appropriate, I mean, you can add all of these up and divide them, but I would just keep it simple and just say 0.75 or 75% is the learning rate. All right, so that takes care of everything that we need to discuss for Chapter 7S. Let's go ahead and find out what's going to be on the quiz. All right, so for the solve problems, you're going to want to know how to do number 1 and number 2. That's for the solve problems. There are no key terms for this. So for the discussion and review questions, let's say number 2. Number 4. Number 9. And number 10. Let me see. Yeah, that should be enough. So for the discussion and review questions, number 2. Number 4. Actually, I add number 6 to that too. Number 6, number 9, and number 10. So that's what you need to know for the quiz. All right, for the current event assignment, you just go down to your name and you do your chart when you get down to slide number 5.